Please turn your Bibles to 1 Timothy chapter 1, and we will look at that chapter beginning in verse 3, 1 Timothy chapter 1. I want to read down through verse 11, 1 Timothy chapter 1, 3 through 11. Of course, Paul is writing a young man who is a special young man to him. He is a preacher of the gospel. He knows that Timothy is going to be around for a while after Paul has died. And he has these things in the first letter to him to say to him. As I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus when I went into Macedonia, that you might discharge some that they teach no other doctrine, neither give heed to fables and endless genealogies, which minister questions rather than godly edifying, which is in faith, so do. Now the end of the commandment is charity out of a pure heart and of good conscience and of faith unfeigned, from which some, having swerved, have turned aside unto vain jangling, desiring to be teachers of the law, understanding neither what they say nor whereof they affirm. But we know that the law is good if a man use it lawfully, knowing this, that the law is not made for a righteous man, but for the lawless and disobedient, for the ungodly and for sinners, for unholy and profane, for murderer of fathers and murderers of mothers, for manslayers, for whoremongers, for them that defile themselves with mankind, for men stealers, for liars, for perjured persons. And if there be any other thing that is contrary to sound doctrine, according to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which was committed to my trust. I think I can safely say that all of us have friends and family who have different religious beliefs, and we're all wanting, in view of what we studied this morning about the authority of the Bible and it being God's Word, everyone to be saved. I know it's right to desire that because God does, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, 2 Peter 3:9. Yet there are always going to be those who will not hear the truth, and many who hear it and even understand it, who will rebel at it for whatever reason and will not obey it. If you turn over to the second letter of Paul to Timothy, chapter 4, most of us in the Lord's church are familiar with this great charge. For he commands Timothy, saying, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom, preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. We have probably all gone by various denominational church buildings, and we probably read sometimes when they have marquees, various slogans on them. There was one that I thought pretty well summed up the denominational world's attitude toward doctrine. It said simply, love God, love others, the rest is doctrine. Well, I suppose they didn't know that the Bible teaches we're to love God That's doctrine. And that the Bible teaches we're to love others. As far as I know, that's doctrine. In fact, anything that you believe, as far as Christianity is concerned, has to do with your doctrine. Now, it may be a doctrine contrary to the New Testament, but it's doctrine, which means simply teaching. But too many people have the idea that it doesn't matter what you teach, just love God, and you'll love your fellow man. I'm surprised, no longer am I surprised. There was a time when I was surprised to learn that many members of the church have digressed to that level of thinking. Some years ago, now a long time ago, there was a fellow by the name of Carl Ketcherside. He started out saying, and with a faction of brethren who taught the same thing, saying and contending for, well, you don't preach gospel to the church. You preach gospel to those outside the church so you can convert them to Christ. You preach doctrine to the church. Then there came a fellow along in recent years, even though he's died now, a fellow by the name of Cecil Hook. It's been a long time in New Braunfels. Who was contending for a false doctrine on marriage, divorce and remarriage. It's pretty well taught that anybody can marry as many times as they want, and it's all right with God, regardless of the reason they divorced. He wrote this in a book that was circulated quite a bit a few years ago, Free in Christ, and he wrote this about gospel and doctrine. I'm quoting Hook. Although these two kinds of messages are not isolated into different paragraphs, books, or epistles, there is a valid distinction to be made. There is the gospel which brings us into life and the teachings which direct our lives. The gospel gets us on the life raft, and the apostolic teachings guide us on to ultimate rescue. The gospel gets us on the Lord's workforce, and the doctrine directs our work on the job. The gospel brings us into fellowship, while the doctrine slash teaching guides those in fellowship. Now you may say, well, that doesn't sound so bad. If you knew the Bible better, you wouldn't say that, because the New Testament makes no distinction between gospel and doctrine. But this fellow did. And so, making that distinction, he taught a false doctrine. And thus, he's a false teacher in more ways than one. In effect, what he was doing was saying that gospel is essential. It's a must, whatever he defined gospel to be. But doctrine, not so much. Again, he wrote, in that same book, under the same heading, the gospel is the faith which was already delivered, now mind you, already delivered, Jude 3, to which they were obedient, Acts 6, 7, which Elymas resisted, Acts 13, 8, in which the disciples should continue, Acts 14, 22, which was the basis of unity, Ephesians 4, 13. The faith is the basis of our salvation. He goes ahead. Differences of scruples and convictions about the teachings were matters of faith. Romans 14 deals with this point. One man had a faith to eat all things, while another one was weak in faith with scruples. Verses 1 and 2, he says, the faith, he puts in parenthesis, convictions you have, keep between yourself and God. Verse 22. One who violates his scruples or convictions does not act from faith, hence he sins. Verse 23. Again, that sounds good. But he means that gospel is to be preached only by the church to those outside of Christ to convert them. And that's the only way the word gospel is used. And doctrine is to be preached to the church, but it's really not that important. You see, he was trying to say we shouldn't divide over certain things. And we shouldn't divide over doctrine. In view of his definition of it. It's gospel that's essential, to love God, to love Christ, to recognize you're sinners, recognize you can't save yourself, recognize that Jesus is the Christ and He's the only Savior. Now that we can't divide over, but we can use mechanical instrument music. We can take the Lord's Supper on Saturday afternoon. We can do all sorts. This is doctrine to the church. That may sound strange if you're a good Bible student to your ears, because how could you believe that? Well, see, it's a matter of definition of terms. And it's a matter of rightly dividing the word of truth. And you can't rightly divide the word of truth in not properly defined terms. The idea is that the gospel saves, but anything labeled doctrine is really not necessary to salvation. And thus, in order to have unity, we can believe different from that. He goes ahead. The gospel message of the faith was once for all delivered to the saints. Well, I think I've already pointed that out. But here's the difference. Here's the difference. We know that the Bible uses different terms for the same thing in order to more fully describe or to emphasize different aspects. Thus, when you study about the word church, you know that the compound Greek words from which we get church would mean it's called out. Well, called out of what? From worldly life, called out by the gospel to live for the Lord. That's the reason that individual members are called saints, that we're to be sanctified. We're set apart by our belief and obedience to the gospel to live a different way from the way the people of the world live. It's also called, that is, the institution of the saved. It's called the kingdom. It's called the body of Christ. It's called God's house or His family. These are not different organizations or groups, but different terms for the same organization. And in understanding them, we understand more about the church, because the church has all these aspects. You'll remember that Sergius Paulus was a non-believer, but he desired to hear the word of God, according to Luke in Acts 13, 6 through 7. Well, since God has located His power to save man from sin in the gospel message, Romans 1, 16, then he would be wanting to hear the gospel when he wanted to hear the word of God. He would want to hear that which God had ordained to save men. In Acts 13 and 12, the scripture says of Sergius Paulus, who was called a prudent man, that after Paul had worked miracles that confirmed that he was speaking by the Holy Spirit God's will from heaven and not his own thinking, you notice it doesn't say he was astonished at the miracles. Have you ever noticed that? He saw those miracles, but he was astonished at the doctrine. Wait a minute, he's outside of Christ. You don't preach doctrine to one outside of Christ. You preach gospel. So it's obvious then that in this one example alone, gospel is doctrine, gospel is the word, and doctrine is gospel, and doctrine is the word. These are different terms applied to the same body of teaching. Just as in that body of teaching, there are different terms applied to the church. And in understanding those terms, we understand the church more fully. So the word for teaching is the Greek word didache, or doctrine. Now, when we read a moment ago from Paul's first letter to Timothy, chapter 1, 3 through 11, I want you to notice that Paul calls it both sound teaching or doctrine and glorious gospel. Did you notice that? He's referring to this same body of teaching. It's the gospel, it's doctrine. Sometimes that which passes as sermons is not much, because all sermons be worth anything teach. If you've got a whole audience of people that are not members of the Lord's church, then you teach them. You teach them what they need to hear, because you're taking them where they are and you're trying to lead them to Christ. You teach them. You engage in doctrinal discourses. You preach the gospel. And we notice from 2 Timothy 4:1-4 to preach the word. He talks about with all longsuffering and doctrine. That is instruction. Sermons are worth nothing unless they instruct people relative to how to become Christians and how to live the Christian life. And if a sermon does that, doesn't do that, it is worthless. It might make everybody all roused up and act like a bunch of people at the Super Bowl. But I've said this many times, though not lately. When a preacher gets through preaching a sermon, go away into a quiet place after you've paid proper attention to the sermon preached, of course, and just ask yourself this question. Now, what did he say? What did he really say? What was the topic? What was the point? What was the subject? How did he reason with it? How did he use the scriptures? What conclusion did he come to? You know, it wouldn't hurt for us to learn how to listen to a sermon, would it? But if you conclude, I don't know what he said. And I was trying to understand him. I was trying to understand his topic. I was trying to listen to how he unfolded that topic. I really don't know what he's trying to get at. Some years ago, quite a few years ago, there was a man who preached a sermon. And he did it without giving any explanation. He just ordered the whole thing by quoting scripture. Well, that's good, isn't it? Shouldn't we all try to know more scripture by heart and be able to quote it when we need to? So that within itself wasn't wrong. But a fellow came up to me after that was over with, been a member of the church most all his life. He was just thrilled. Did you hear that man? The whole sermon, he never used one word. He just quoted scriptures. Isn't that amazing? I asked him one question. What did he say? I'm still waiting for an answer. He was just impressed that he quoted scripture. Well, I admit that takes mental effort and ability to learn the scriptures. I don't want to discourage that. Wish I knew the scriptures even better than I do, a lot better than I do from the standpoint of being able to quote the Bible. I'd love just to be able to refer to any scripture, never have to look at my Bible, just know it by heart and quote it. I can't do that. But don't you think you ought to be impressed with a little more than the fact that somebody quoted scripture? There ought to have been something he was trying to teach you in quoting those scriptures. Now, understand, I'm not saying the man didn't do that. I'm just saying sometimes people are impressed with things when really they didn't get the message in the first place. I'm afraid that's the way it is with a lot of preachers. They look so good and they sound so good and they tell such beautiful stories and they have all sorts of oratorical powers. And sometimes they're even handsome and all of the younger women sort of ooh and coo over, did you hear Brother So-and-so's sermon? Just don't know what we would do without him, Gary. Well, you'd live your life and die like everybody else. That's what you'd do without him. Now what you do in between the two is the thing that's so important. But what are we listening for when we listen? Well, I'm doing that because somebody's asked me here, and I love them, and I'm going to come here, and I like them, and they're my friend, so I'll just sit there and tolerate the whole thing. Well, that's not the fault of the preacher. Jesus Christ himself even said a lot of them followed him for the loaves and fishes rather than for the information he had to give. He had to rebuke Martha because she was in the kitchen. You know, she was doing a good thing. You ever realize that? Martha was doing a real good thing. She had all that bunch in the living room. She was trying to get dinner ready for them. And she called out to Jesus to send Mary to come in the kitchen and help her. That word help only appears twice in the original language of the New Testament. Likely, what she's saying is, you know, sometimes you get a bunch of people over. Tell Mary to come in here and grab one end of this table so I can, together, we get it moved over here. It's that kind of help. You ever notice the Lord's response? Now, there's nothing wrong with what she was doing. She was doing what she ought to. What women always did that kept house and were being good hostesses. But Jesus said, Martha, Martha, thou art encumbered about too many things. Mary has chosen the better part. You know, it's not every day Jesus in the living room teaching. Could you think you could find time to come out and sit down and listen? There's a lot that has to do with why we don't know the Bible. Some of it has to do with the fellows who are trying to teach it. James deals with that, you know. Don't be many masters. Well, he's not trying to say don't be good enough to teach. Right of Hebrews, rebuke brethren, for when for the time they ought to be teachers. Now they have need of being taught again. First principles, the oracles of God. That's because they hadn't used what they learned when they learned it so they could grow. So when he says, be not many teachers or masters, he's not saying, well, don't ever aspire to become a teacher. I've known some people in the church for years. They couldn't teach a thing to anybody verbally. I don't know why they're that way. But everybody who's a member of the church, according to their several abilities and role in the church, is expected to teach the gospel to everybody else. Maybe mothers teaching your children. Maybe talking to a neighbor. But that's part of our obligation, being faithful to the Lord. So we got to know when these things come up and somebody says, oh, you can't preach gospel to the church. You preach it only to non-members. You preach only doctrine to the church. And the thing that gets them saved, you see, there's where we ought to unite. But don't let any of these other quibbles over what we do as Christians that falls under doctrine cause us to be separated. Some things smell so good to people who are wanting to find an excuse to be with everybody anyway. But the Bible just doesn't substantiate that. The gospel is the doctrine of Christ, and the doctrine of Christ is the gospel of Christ. And the gospel of Christ and the doctrine of Christ is the faith for which we are to contend. Have you noticed, too, that when Paul is writing the Roman letter, he's writing the church? Now, according to Ketcherside and others, such as Cecil Hook, Paul shouldn't have said what he did in that letter when he says, I'm ready to preach the gospel to you who are at Rome also. Now, Paul, wait a minute. That's the church in Rome you're addressing in this letter that'll make up part of the New Testament. Don't you know, as an apostle of Christ, inspired of the Holy Spirit, writing part of the New Testament, that you can't preach the gospel to the church, and yet you said you're ready to preach the gospel to those at Rome? Amazing. Truth of the matter is, I say again, in rightly dividing the word of truth, we have to look at those terms. We have to make sure we're using them like the Bible said. The idea of evangelist really carries with it more the idea of heralding out the gospel. It doesn't remove one from teaching it. It's just that you herald it out to the lost. That's the fundamental meaning of euangelistes, from which comes evangelist. Doesn't remove it from teaching. You remember when Philip preached, we referred to him this morning, to the Ethiopian eunuch, he preached unto him Jesus. Well, there Jesus stands for the whole gospel system he needed to know relative to how to become a Christian. We do that all the time in using words. That's called a synecdoche in the English language, where a part stands for the whole thing. Or sometimes, the whole for part. In this case, belief is such an important part of the gospel system that it's used to stand for the whole gospel system. Doctrine is essential. We should walk in the commandments of the Lord. This is what John taught, 2 John verse 6. And this is love. Have you ever said to somebody, show me love? Show me the love of Christians. Show me the love of Christians for themselves. Show me the love of Christians for those outside of Christ in need of the gospel. Show me the love of Christians for their God. That's not hard to do. And this is love. He's going to show it to us. That we walk after His commandments. This is the commandment that as you've heard from the beginning, you should walk in it. Now, if you go back to 1 John, we'll just go from the back to the front. The old fellow said one time we'll skin it from the top to the bottom. Other time said we'd skin it from the bottom to the top. Well, whichever way we're starting here, we'll skin it. In 1 John 5 and verse 2, writing to Christians, he said, by this we know that we love the children of God. How do you know you love your brothers and sisters in Christ? Well, he tells you right here. when we love God and keep His commandments. Is that hard? Does seem hard to me. You see, when Paul withstood Peter to the face because he was to be blamed, Peter played the hypocrite. Because when certain had come from Jerusalem to Antioch of Syria, some of the Jews, including Barnabas, pulled away, wouldn't eat those Gentiles. They were eating with them before those came from Jerusalem. And Paul says, I withstood Peter to the face because he was to be blamed. And then he explains why. Didn't he know that was just a part of doctrine among brethren and it was all right to make those mistakes and it shouldn't cause any division? Paul didn't seem to think so. Paul seemed to think that he needed confronting. Have you ever noticed in our society that the word confront or confrontation has become a politically incorrect word? If you study psychology or how to reconcile people one another who are separated over whatever issue it might ever be, you don't want to use that word. But that's exactly what Christians are to do. Somebody sins against you, the Bible says rebuke him. If he repent, forgive him. Well, what's a rebuke? Look, you say you're a Christian, Peter, but you violated the scriptures when you wouldn't eat with these Gentile brethren because you didn't want to be seen eating with them by those folks that came from Jerusalem. That was a confrontation. When he says it withstood him to the face, it literally in the Greek says Paul was mouth to mouth with him. You know what that's really saying? Paul was in his face. But you don't do that, you see. But how do I know that you love me or I love you? Well, there's more, you see, in dealing with one another, brothers and sisters, this rebuking people for their sins. But that seems to be an area to where we're sort of, well, you know, you just want to do that. Let's go along to get along. But it's all a part of living the Christian life. If you look in verse 3 of 1 John 5, for this is the love of God. It's sort of like he did in 2 John. Here's the love of God. You want to see it? We can show people the love of God, that we keep his commandments. And his commandments are not grievous. Well, how is it that his commandments sometimes aren't grievous? Because when you know what God says to you in placing an obligation on you, is never but for your own good, and it involves other people for their good too, that it is the way to do it. It's the right thing to do. It's not grievous then, because you see, a long time ago when you obeyed the gospel, you said for the rest of your life, not my will but thine be done. If you look on back through 1 John, I won't try to read them all now. But here's verse 29 of chapter 2. If ye know that he is righteous, ye know that everyone that doeth righteousness is born of him. Now that's all doctrine, folks. There's just no getting around it. And we should walk then in the commandments of Christ, and that way we know we're right, and we know we're right toward everybody else, no matter how other people say, no, that's not the thing to do. You do that and you can't come back home. You do that and you can't be my friend. You do that and you're going to get fired as the preacher. You do that and you're going to fall out there body in the church. Well, what is that? Keeping commandments of God. But we all know and can quote that Jesus said, if you love me, honk your horn. We all know that that's what that scripture says. I'm being facetious. This is obvious. If you love me, John 14:15, keep my commandments. The American Standard translated, we will keep my commandments. Now, there were false teachers denying that Jesus came in the flesh, according to 2 John verse 7. The faith that Jesus came in the flesh will be called gospel by followers of Hook or Ketcherside. But we've already seen that's a distinction the New Testament does not make between the word gospel and the word doctrine. If you read 2 John 9 through 11, it's rather obvious that things get rather touchy when you violate the doctrine of Christ, because he's talking about the relationship, the fellowship that exists between brothers and sisters in Christ, those who have obeyed the gospel. And he says, whosoever transgresseth and abideth not in, the doctrine. What doctrine? Of Christ hath not God. Sounds like to me, he goes out of fellowship with God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed. For he that biddeth him Godspeed is a partaker of his evil deeds. Now the Lord said they're evil deeds. When a man makes a distinction that the Bible doesn't make in saying doctrine is for the church and the gospel is for the one outside of Christ, and never the two shall mix, and you do that simply to be able to say we can disagree over all these things that Christians disagree over because we've been saved. All we need to make sure we stay one on is what it takes to become a Christian to get into the favor of God. The rest of it, yeah, well, believe differently, but don't fall out about it. That's not what it said here. Some people say, oh, he's just talking about the doctrine that Christ is the Son of God. That's not what that says. He's talking about the doctrine that flows from Christ, that is the New Testament system, the faith for which we are to contend. Because remember, the New Testament does not make a distinction between gospel and doctrine, as they're two different things. One argument was that if doctrine was necessary, it's too much to learn and no one could be saved. Well, it seems to me that nowadays people hardly want to even learn to spell the word Bible. That just takes too much time. We're living in the age of convenience, folks, and it's hit the church about as hard as hit everywhere else. If you can't get everything just set just right at the right time, I ain't coming. I'm not doing it. Because you got convenience food. You ever thought what happened to this economy if you remove convenience food from it? Well, that reflects how we think about everything. Convenient religion. Well, you've got convenient funeral homes where you can drive by and not even get out of the car and view the corpse. And you know one reason more and more people are being cremated, which is fine with me. But really, when you consider the motive, it's convenience. Especially when it comes to the pocketbook, and that's also important because you know you're going to take that with you when you die. You'll remember that Jesus said in giving the Great Commission, as Matthew recorded it in Matthew 18:20, that those who were baptized were to observe all the commandments. It was the great salvation first spoken by the Lord, according to the inspired writer of Hebrews, Hebrews 2:3. Actually, doctrine is all that is taught. It is the act of teaching and not a restricted set of topics. You see, the fellow's false even when he does what he does in saying one argument. Or at least setting out that argument that if doctrine was necessary, it's too much to learn and no one could be saved. Claiming that there's a lot to learn doesn't mean it doesn't have to be learned. And we understand that when it comes to about any secular subject. I sure hope my doctors did. And I'm going to close by telling you this little story. When I first went to the hospital a couple of weeks ago, they had diagnosed me with pneumonia, or at least what they thought was pneumonia. As the doctor said, there's something going on in your lungs, and I think it's viral. All I knew is I was miserable. So he told us where we could go, and he thought which place to go so we wouldn't have to wait so long in the emergency room, and so we did. And at Memorial Hermann in the Woodlands, we got in to see the doctor. And I will give you a pointer if you don't already know it. If you'll just be real short of breath and pain in your chest, you'll get the headline. So anyway, when they were giving me this whatever it once over, they said, we're going to treat you. In fact, they started me right there. And you know how they have the rooms in the emergency area before they ever put you in a room. And they started me on an antibiotic drip there, which I stayed on all night the next day, about three different kind of whatevers. But this one doctor out of three I saw there said, you know, I think probably it is pneumonia, but I just want to check the hunch out that I have. I want to check you for blood clots. I like that doctor. Because when they gave me the nuclear stuff, you know, the room was dark. I asked the other one to get back in there if they gave me that because I had to breathe it in. I said, am I glowing? Be one of the few times you can say how your husband was glowing. Although I sure didn't feel like joking about it then. And then when they did the sonogram on my leg, there it was. 2 blood clots. I'm glad that doctor paid attention in that class. I'm glad he was thinking outside the box. Now they treated me, which I think probably was right, for pneumonia the whole weekend or most of it. But they also treated me for this. So I had all kinds of medicines. Now, you know, there's a great physician, folks. He deals with spiritual matters. He's infallible because, you see, he's our creator. He knows us. And he's diagnosed us all under sin, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. And the wages of sin is death, separation from God and physical death. The Lord doesn't come back first, Romans 6:23. And he doesn't miss anything. He knows exactly the remedy. And he knows how we can learn the truth, but he expects us to have the initiative and the hungering and the thirsting to pursue the study of this book. We can do that. And he's guaranteed us we'll learn the way of salvation so we can have forgiveness of sin. And part of that is to learn to see through false teachers. Oh, but gospel's different. To be preached to the lost who are not Christians, and doctrine's only to be preached to the church. And we shouldn't divide if it's just over doctrine. Let's make sure we continue to be united on gospel. That sounds so good. Except that gospel and doctrine mean the exact same thing. And you learn that by reading and understanding the words and the infallibility of the book. It's from God. I wouldn't have to read anything anymore to learn that was wrong than where Paul desired to preach the gospel to the youth at Rome. And he was addressing the church. Well, back up a little bit. Somebody's got something messed up. You know, a few years ago, there was Big F, Little F Fellowship popped up. It was the same thing. Just somebody else wanted to get his name on it by learning it from someone else and yet wanting him to know, think they came up with it on their own. Because Big F Fellowship took the same position as gospel in Catcher's Side and Hook's Place, and Little F Fellowship was what we have because we're members of the church. And you don't want to divide over Big F, uppercase fellowship. You can be different on doctrine or lowercase fellowship. People who don't respect the authority of the Word of God and have ceased to believe it can come up with about anything in the world and dress it up in such a way as to get gullible people. This last verse ought to tell us that people hasn't changed at all. Where Paul is closing out his letter to the church at Rome. These last few words. Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they are such that serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the innocent. Simple, American Standard has innocent. Brethren, if we don't stay close to that book, something will catch us. Just the way Satan operates. That's why Paul said we're not ignorant of Satan's devices. What some of us are. What sounds good, what appears on the surface to look good, can through further study be examined, and you can learn what the will of the Lord is. Well, if you're not a Christian, I can only urge you by the powers I have, by the truth of the gospel, to become a Christian. A member of the New Testament church. You can read about it in your own Bible if you've never heard about me. Bible's written so you can understand. You take the time and the interest, you can learn the way of salvation. to believe in Christ, repent of your sins, confess your faith in Christ, and be baptized for the remission of sins. As a Christian, live faithful in the Lord's church all the days of your life. As a child of God, if you've sinned, we urge you to repent and pray for forgiveness, having confessed those sins. What better time than now, because that's all you have, and you may never have any more, to respond to the gospel invitation.